Right now, what we're trying to do is just strive to promote the interests of people, to include people that have been systematically excluded from our country, and at the same time, try to help at the international level. We have many programs going on in, for instance, the Caribbean region with Petro Caribe. It's an energy project that is used to help the Caribbean countries to overcome the situation they face in the energy, and at the same time have some resources to promote different projects, economic projects in all those countries. All the Caribbean countries are participating in Petro Caribe. In the U.S., as the chairman said, we have a Heating Our Project. Heating Our Project is a project that helps poor people, indigenous people in the U.S. to have access to heating oil that in any other case they wouldn't have access to. We believe in cooperation. Together with Cuba, back in 2003, we organized the Bolivarian Alliance for the People of America, ALBA. It is an international project where right now there are 12 countries participating. Among them, we have Nicaragua, Cuba, Venezuela, Bolivia, Ecuador, Dominica, Antigua, Barbuda, and I don't remember the others. But all these countries, instead of, you know, most of the time we understand an international activity as a kind of competence, like the Free Trade Agreement. The Free Trade Agreement is supposed to allow different countries to free the market so that the different companies can compete among themselves, and we will see the best one be the owner of the market. There was a free trade agreement signed recently. And in fact, the free trade agreement is just an agreement to promote the interests of corporations. That's the main issue. You know, workers don't come neither in the U.S. nor in the other countries. In the case of, for instance, in Mexico, the agricultural sector in Mexico was destroyed, and that's why there are a lot of Mexicans coming to the U.S. You know, because they don't have jobs in their countries. Well, in the case of ALBA, ALBA is designed to cooperate, not to compete. There is a good experience. For instance, we make an agreement with Cuba. We need a lot of doctors in Venezuela, and Cuba have a lot of doctors. And Cuba need energy, so we exchange energy for doctors. While the doctor in Venezuela, Cuba have the energy. With Nicaragua, we exchange energy for agricultural stuff. No. And so we have been working with other countries in that way, cooperating. We organized also an international health project called Misión Milagro. So people from different countries, even from the U.S., can go to Cuba and Venezuela and get a surgery in case that they have some kind of disease. Free, completely free. They don't have to pay anything. And those people are the people that didn't have any access to the formal health sector. Right now we are cooperating within the educational sector, Latin American School of Medicine. We organized a School of Medicine in Venezuela just like the one that Cuba has. And there are people signed there from all Latin American countries, even from some African countries. Because they're free, they don't have to pay anything to study medicine. But you know, it looks easy. It seems like it's easy to do all these things, but the first people that get that graduate from that school this year, we graduate about 8,500 people. The former medical sector of Venezuela said that it was a bad idea to get those doctors because they don't have the skills to be doctors. And there is a big discussion right now in Venezuela about that, because it seems that it is impossible to have a doctor outside the formal sector. It's not the formal sector, the traditional sector, I would say. So the doctor that learn medicine in terms of business, as in most of our country, the doctor that that we are being the lead in the Latin American School of Medicine, learn medicine in terms of cooperation, in terms of helping people, of social interest, not their business. So there is a contradiction between the formal sector that we have, the traditional sector of medicine, and this new sector that we're working on, that we are organizing, because we won't have the Cuban working personnel of the life. We need our own doctor, and we're working on that. But now there is this big discussion with the organization of doctors in Venezuela. They think that it's something negative to Venezuela to have this doctor. But I understand that, you know, in traditionally in Venezuela, we graduate annually like 1,500 doctors. And in the School of Medicine, we're graduating like 8,500 doctors. Big difference, you know. So that's the kind of problem that we are facing right now in Venezuela. As you know, we are not threatening the U.S. any other country. We don't have traditional international war like in our country. We've never been involved in any international conflict. We don't have tradition of terrorists. We don't know what is that. Of course, we suffered a terrorist attack in 1976 when Posada Carriles just exploded an airplane and killed about 75 people. And that guy is living here in the U.S. without any problem. This is free. We don't have nuclear weapons. We don't have nuclear energy. We don't understand how we can have relations with, you know, different organizations that have different traditions. For instance, the media here in the U.S. say that we have terrorists from the FARC, Colombia. Then we also have terrorists from Midwest. And we also have terrorists from Europe, from the ETA. They try to present Venezuela as if we have a school of terrorists in our country. But we cannot teach terrorism because we don't have experience of terrorism. That's the main problem. What I think, living here in Venezuela, in the U.S. for 4 years, is that what they try to do is to avoid that the people, not only in the U.S., but at the international level, understand that the government can use the resources they have to solve the problem of people, in terms of health, in terms of education, in terms of housing. That's the main concern they have. Because they're not doing that, you know. We have a recently a conference in Venezuela, a labor conference. A bunch of like 7,000 labor active this meeting, and President Chavez was talking at the conference. And he said that he had the commitment with working with the worker movement, he's gonna change the law. We have been trying to change the labor law for 10 years. We're gonna change the law, he's gonna change a lot of difficult situations workers are facing. We established as a public policy the Venezuelan government that no worker had to be outsourced. You know, the traditional resource that corporation use to eliminate workers' right, outsourcing. So you are working in a factory, getting a good wage with social security, everything. Then they decide, oh, you know, you have to work right now with this other company outside our organization. You won't have this protection, and you will receive instead of $30 per hour, you will receive like 15 hours per hour. You know. So we forbidden that, and we're working to overcome that kind of tradition in which workers are excluded from all the formal sector of health, education, and housing. Through this. In terms of the African-Venezuelan situation, we organized a conference last year. trying to connect all those African people that think that we have some pride, that we need to come together to promote our interests, our agenda. It was the first conference organized with this aim, because we understand that right wing is trying to use the African movement to promote the neoliberal agenda. In fact, they organized a conference. We organized a conference in July, and they organized a conference in August. Business conference, you know, all these guys talking about businesses and with the support of multilateral organization, and talking about neoliberal projects, talking about free trade agreement. That was the main concern of that conference. We organized our, in our conference, we talk about, for instance, the situation of Haiti. The need that we have to have the economic support from the government. We propose to public fund in the country of Alba to develop projects that include Afro-American people. And when I'm talking about Afro-American, I'm talking about the African that live in America, not only in the US, because that's a long problem.